Hello? I'm Artifacts of Mars, and this is a Tyranny Watch News special field report. Donald Trump comes to Rochester, New York. Coming to you from the frozen plains of sunny western New York State, where winter is holding on like a bulldog to a bone. I'm not at the actual location yet. I gotta take the bus. I heard it was out of security concerns. But, we will be doing a... We'll be doing whatever we need to do to document this. I have not seen the American Sandinistas yet. No protesters in sight. Just for documentation. Anyway, this is like the Rochester Tech Park or something. They decided not to make it all that easy. Coming from where I come, this place is a real bitch to find. And one of the maps was bogus, so I took an alternative. Anyway, we will go to the location and we will see what's going on with that. No American Sandinistas that I can see at the moment. Stand by. T-shirts and hats and so forth. That's a great American tradition, just for documentation. And I am headed to the buses. I got yellow school buses up ahead. This is Artifacts of Mars, just for documentation. I think I walked about a tenth of a mile before I found the end of the line, and people are loading into the buses. Monroe County School Transportation. I do not live in Monroe County, so I don't know what. I know some of the basic roads, that's about it.
What's that?
Nothing really to see here, so I'll probably save my batteries for when we get to the actual place, the hangar. It's called JetSmart or something. This is Artifacts of Mars. I have arrived at the place. There's a handful of protesters across the street. They're harmless and not doing anything wrong or anything. So I don't have any problem with it as long as they keep it peaceful. And there's a heavy police presence, as you can see. This is like a hangar. It's called JetSmart. I'm not familiar. I haven't flown in years.
Everything out of your pocket, everything metal out of your pocket. Straight ahead, folks, cut the wall all the way down. Oh, yeah. You're gonna have to turn that off when you go through the,
Hello, this is Artifacts of Mars. And this is some extra footage that I shot before the actual event. It's just a few minutes long, and I'm going to take the time to discuss what was going on there. The big plane you saw on the ground there was the C-47, a transport circa 1943. It flew in D-Day. Just to give you an idea. That's what I was told about. And here's some other planes sitting on the ground. There's C-47. The crowd went ballistic when guys came out of the cockpit on top of it, stuck their heads out. The crowd went nuts. Believe me, I think that was the loudest cheers of all, not for Trump, but for that plane. And then they raised the flag. American flag out of the cockpit, and the crowd went nuts. Here's the media. They got booed twice, very loudly. People don't like them. Gee, I wonder why. This is why I use alternative news sources for the most part. Some mainstream. Well, I prefer alternative news sources when I can find them. For a simple reason, I know these are a bunch of lying sacks of garbage. Especially when it comes to politics. Okay, there's the C-47 again. C-47A. Now, the crowd was going nuts. The guy stuck his head out. Now, at one point, you'll see a... During the Trump speech, you'll see me see a punk with a black flag. He was an anarchist. From what I understand. That was in local media. He was a troublemaker and an anarchist. And there were a few others in there that were kind of raising little cane. I was not close to them. I was close to the punk. And I couldn't find his flag anywhere on the internet. But I did learn from the media that's what it was. They're good, useful for some things, I suppose. But isn't it a beauty? I'm playing smaller than it looks like on TV. On TV, it looks like this gigantic thing. Still big. Well, that's about it. We'll get to the speech. There's Trump's plane, by the way, they flew in on. Small, private, twin prop, plane. Came in. I saw us walking into the place. Well, that's about it. And get to the speech. This is on the back of Mars. And Donald Trump is up there somewhere, I'm not seeing him.
I was reading the morning paper.
Oh, like in the air?
Just how square it is. For these people in Washington who think that they own us and can control us. Think about how hideous it is that these people want to deny us the opportunity to select our own leader. They can actually talk about a brokered convention and suggest that they can take that right away from the American people to choose their leader. How brazen is that? How can people become so out of touch with the reality of America? The reality that we're a country that has the rule of law. We have a constitution. Our parents told us, go to school, work hard. Achieve. You too can enjoy the American dream if you do these things. That's what our parents told us. But now we spent the last 7 years with a leader who wants to tell us that he doesn't have to obey the rules, that he doesn't have to follow the rules. It makes you wonder As a parent today, can you tell your children about the future as our parents could tell us about the future? How horrible is that? That we can't project out a year or even 6 months of where our country's going to be. We can't give our kids confidence that they too can have the American dream and live it. We can't tell them that because we've allowed a bunch of charlatans, a bunch of phonies to take over the leadership of America. And now they want to deny us our right to choose our leader. That's why we're all in this room today. We're here to show America, to show the rest of this country, to show the states that are going to follow New York in this election, to show them all that we're united and we're not going to take it, we're not going to back down. His values and fight that good fight. And win or lose, he enjoyed that opportunity to fight. And that's what Donald Trump is. And he's going to win. $250 million of Sandy money that should have gone for the relief of those families. families. We spent an advertising New York as a business-friendly state. Then he turns around and gets into minimum wage law and a family leave law, okay, that are going to scare more businesses and hurt more of the little guys in the state and deny them an opportunity for success.
I wasn't born yet. true, Matt. Dear party.
Donald Trump!
I want to
party deal because Donald Trump is making sure about the voice of the people instead of the special interest group.
Yeah!
for a long time, and we're going to make it better, okay? Call Paladino. Where did they come from? Where did these people come from? Where did they come from? Turn around, you folks. I want to thank Call Paladino, James Howe, Bill Nojay, and Bill Riley. Thank you. So let's talk a little bit about Rochester for a second, because we're here, we come upstate, I know what's been going on for a long time. This same group, including Carl and many others, they asked me to run for governor. Between you and I sort of said, I'm sorry, but I'm doing something else. I didn't want to say it. This is what the something else was. Bigger effect on upstate New York and on Rochester by doing what I'm doing than I could have even as governor. You would have been fracking by now a long time ago. It is sad that when you go at the line and you see in Pennsylvania machines boom, boom, boom all the way up and down the line, and yet on the right of the line we can't have those machines because they're bad for the environment. Okay, so explain it. We could have wiped out our debt in New York. We could have wiped out our debt. But hey, we will get it straightened out, folks. One way or the other, we're going to get it straightened out. It's in statistics. I just didn't spend the way up, and I wanted to do it. And I have a lot of friends that are here from this area, and they're hanging in there. They're not leaving. But in New York State, lost 3 out of 4 manufacturing jobs that existed in 1960. You know, when you think of that, 3 out of 4. Rochester, which is an amazing place with amazing people, which we see today, has lost more than half of its manufacturing jobs since 1997 due to NAFTA, Asian countries, China. I've been talking about this for 5 years, for 7 years, forever. Century State just left, they moved to Mexico, right?
I
want to go! I'm stopping. I would stop them so fast your heads would spin. And I guarantee you one thing, I'm not buying Century State, that's for sure, right? I'm not buying the product. The entire country lost one-third of its manufacturing jobs since 1997. Think of that. How sick is that? How sad and how stupid? How stupid is it that we put up with it? One-third of its jobs manufacturing since 1997. Since 1999, Rochester has lost 32% of its transportation jobs, 30% of its building and ground maintenance jobs, and 43% of its science jobs. 43%. Got it. You do. You need somebody fast. I know that. You watch. Okay. Yeah. I mean, how much longer do we have, right? How much longer? It's
gonna not be much.
TPP, listen to this, that's the trade pact, which is a disaster. It will be worse for you, for Rochester, for upstate New York, for New England, for the entire country. It will be worse than NAFTA. It will be worse. Ted Cruz is totally in favor of it. Lie like him. Because a really good liar doesn't get caught lying, right? vote for me. He's left. This was during election day. And Ben Carson endorsed me, by the way. He's a great man. Which is a disaster. Both of my competitors now are totally endorsing TPP. We'll give 3,000 foreign companies, think of this one, nobody even talks about this, the opportunity to sue New York for the differential in payments because of the United States and New York regulations. We have regulations. These companies are now going to come in and they're going to sue us because we're allowing them to come in. The whole thing is crazy. And we have politicians. They're not so stupid, all of them. Some are stupid, and some are being taken care of by, as you know, their lobbyists, their special interests. Me, I'm self-funding my campaign. So they're going to come in, we're going to end up with thousands of lawsuits over what? Over the fact that we allow them to come in. Rules and regulations, and we have to abide, but we don't have to abide because of them. It's going to end, folks. The stupidity is going to end. Bouncing loan, you know all about bouncing loan. They moved their headquarters out of Rochester. Xerox is outsourcing to IBM in different locations. The whole thing is a catastrophe. Could I ask you a question? I love loyalty. I love the fact that you stay. Why did you stay? Why? Why? You know why you stay? Because you know if I get elected, Rochester is going to boom again, okay? Our whole country is going to boom again. That's why I hear about centuries. So I just heard about it today. They left. They're going to Mexico, they're going to make saves, they're going to let go of 500 people. And here's what's going to happen. And here's what's going to happen, very simply. They're going to make their safe, and I'm going to say, that's wonderful, it's a wonderful product, good luck with it, but you're going to pay a nice big tariff or tax when you call it. You see about corporate inversions, it's a huge problem where companies are moving out of the United States. They get lower taxes. And by the way, my tax policy, low taxes, I cut it. By far the biggest of any of the candidates that ran and that are currently running. But we cut the taxes way, way down for middle-income people because the middle income has been forgotten in this country. We cut them down for business. We're the highest tax nation anywhere in the world. We pay more tax than anybody. We have more rules and regulations than anybody. That's how these TPP countries are going to come in. They probably have clauses where, oh, you don't have to go by the rules and regulations. Then they come, they say, oh, you misrepresented because look at all the rules and regulations. Let's sue the United States. Let's sue New York State. Let's sue Rochester, okay? Get your lawyers ready, folks. And TPP is a disaster ending. All right, so I know how to do this. Now, I watch these politicians. It's so sad. And they don't know how to stop companies from moving. Well, I know how. You just tell those companies, if you move, you're going to be taxed when you sell your product into the United States. And then and they don't want to. Because I love free trade. The problem is, when you are free trade, you need smart dealers. You need smart negotiators. You need smart people running your country. We don't have that. We have the opposite, okay? It's dumb trade because we lose with China, we lose with Mexico, we lose with Japan and Vietnam and every single country that we deal with. We lose with Canada, bigly, tremendous, tremendous trade deficits with Canada. We lose with everybody. We lose, no more is right, no more. It's ending, it's ending. It is ending. And that's why nobody has crowds like this. You know, they stopped the buses from coming in an hour ago. There are thousands of people who want to come in, and they said they had a fire. Look at the size of this hangar. This is a big hangar. Now, the press, which is so disheartened, Shabbos. They want Shabbos.
Thank you very much. We love you too.
We love you. We love each other. We want to make our country great again. You know, like you say, the American dream is dead, but I'm going to make it bigger and better and stronger than ever before. And somebody said the other day, well, what is your policy, like on the military? And I said, America first. America first. The New York Times wrote a terrible misrepresentative story, which they always do. They're totally, you know, it's a failing newspaper. It's probably not going to live for another year. But they write such negative things. Just so, and they know it's wrong. They know it's wrong. They don't vote for the nominee. They don't vote for the
Rochester has some kind of a flag or something. I can't tell what it is, but...
Who has more money than Sony? They were making, before the oil went down, they were making $1 billion.
You're seeing it.
Okay.
From
$1,000.
There are three white arrows on the white flag and nothing else. I don't know what that means. By different people. You have lobbyists in Washington that specialize in Cruz, and they specialize in Hillary. It says Hillary on their forehead. Hillary. I take care of Hillary. And they give them millions of dollars through different people, probably through themselves also. They give millions of dollars, and when there's a problem, you go and you hire those people. And you say, you know, Cruz has caught on to the fact that since you say, or whoever it is moving, and they won't be able to move, they don't want any problems. And you know what? 100%, folks, but no problem. With me, they'll come see me, and I'm going to say, no, 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 I don't care, doesn't matter. They're paying their 35% tariff to get their product. But remember what I just said, a little while ago I said, because it's so important for you, it's more important than for most people, because you've been decimated. You know, a lot of areas that I go to, they've been hurt. Every place has been hurt.
But Rochester in upstate New York has been decimated, okay? Decimated. And let me just tell you, that's why it's so important, and I guess that's why I'm killing everybody in New York in the polls. Why wouldn't I? Because these politicians are all talk, and they're no action, and they'll tell you, and they follow what I say. You know, they see what I say, and then he'll get here, and they'll all get here, and they'll say, we've got to tax them. The other day I heard Ted Cruz say, we want a wall and we'll build a wall. I said, where did that come from? And by the way, speaking of that, we will have strong borders and we will have a wall and Mexico.
I told you, you can see what's going on. And we're winning, and I think we should win before we get to the convention. I think we should. Let me tell you how crooked the system is. I go to Louisiana, worked hard, made speeches. I made a speech in a hangar just like this. It was packed. We had like 15, 16,000 people the night before the election. I left. I wasn't expected to win Louisiana. And I left. I wasn't expected to win. I won 22 or 23 places now. Thank you. 22. You ever see Cruz? He gets up. The only one that can beat Donald Trump, you know, Lion Ted. The only one that can beat Donald Trump. And then he holds the Bible up high. But I've been winning with the evangelicals, which is incredible. I mean, they should. Where he said, the only one that beats Donald Trump is Ted Cruz. Okay, except for one problem. One problem. What's the problem? He said, I've beaten him 6 times. I said, yeah, but I've beaten you 18 times. And he went, it's a weird moment. Now, I've won 21 or 22 states. He's won half that number, maybe less than half that number. I won, here's what's important, which they don't even count because it's a crooked system, folks. It's a crooked system. And in all fairness, take a look at what's happened in Gilbert. He wins, he wins, he wins, he wins. And I hear he doesn't have a chance. This is a crooked system, folks. This is a crooked, I'm not for Bernie, I couldn't care less. You know, as far as I'm concerned, I couldn't care less about Bernie. But he wins, and he wins, like me. I've won twice as much as Cruz. Millions and millions of votes more. People that have never voted are coming out to vote for Trump. The Republican primaries, it's up 70, more than 70%. The Democrats are down 35%. Surprise me. The Republicans, because of me, are up 70%, almost 70%. From 4 years ago, when we had a joke artist named Mitt Romney that should have won that election. We're up 70% from 4 years ago. Now, every one of those people, if they try and do their little shenanigans, which is politics as usual, every one of those people that are all enthused, and look at all the people here today, and to think we have stopped the buses and thousands, please apologize to them. I'll come back. I'll come back. Look at this. So I watch Bernie. He wins. He wins. He keeps winning. Winning, winning. And then I see he's got no chance. They always say he has no chance. Why does he have a chance? Because the system is corrupt. And it's worse on the Republican side. Because I'm up millions of votes on Cruz. Millions. I don't mean like I'm up by 2 votes. I'm up millions and millions of votes. I'm up by hundreds and hundreds of delegates. I go to Louisiana. I win Louisiana. And I say, isn't that beautiful? I love the people. I send them a note. Thank you very much. I love you, Louisiana. Then I find out that I get less delegates than Cruz because of some nonsense going on. See, and I say it to the Republican Party. You're going to have a big problem, folks, because there are people that don't like what's going on. They don't like what's going on. I mean, I win the state of Arizona, and Cruz
wins Utah, which is far less in terms of the number of delegates, right? And then I see Cruz, I won Utah! He doesn't talk about the fact that he got killed in Arizona by a landslide. We've got a corrupt system. It's not right. We're supposed to be a democracy. We're supposed to be, you vote and the vote means something, all right? You vote and the vote means something. And we've got to do something about it. Now, here's what's going to happen. We're doing fine. We should have won it a long time ago. But, you know, we keep losing where we're winning. Today, winning votes doesn't mean anything. This is the only time. Have you ever heard anybody say, other than me today, that Donald Trump has millions of votes more than Cruz? Okay? I have millions of votes more than Cruz. And nobody talks about that. Delegates, I have, I think, about 200, maybe more than that, more. But it's not right, folks. Because what they're doing, and whether it's me or whether it's Bernie Sanders, when I look at it and I see all these victories that I have, all these victories that he's got, and then you look at the establishment, and I want to tell you, it's a corrupt deal going on in this country. It's not good. It's not good. And it's not fair. It's not fair to you people. A reporter, a very fair reporter, just asked me, what do you think would happen if you didn't get it, Mr. Trump? You have all these people. They've never seen. By the way, this is a record crowd. They've never had a crowd like that in the history. People being turned away. The buses couldn't take them here because obviously you don't have any room. But with all of that, they said this is a record crowd, over 10,000 people. They've never had anything like this. And you know what, folks? You know what? They're taking your vote away. They're disenfranchising people that want to see America be great again. And politicians will never do it. They don't want to do it. They can't do it because their lobbyists and special interests are saying, we're not going to let you do it. It's no good. And we've got to change the system. And it's got to change fast. So I think we're going to be fine. We're doing really well. But we've got to have a system where voting means something. Doesn't have to mean something. So Rochester, listen to this beauty. Rochester lost 90,000 jobs since 1970. 4,000 jobs in the last 6 months. 4,000 jobs! Don't leave! Don't leave Rochester! I'm telling you, I will bring it back so fast. Oh. And then they have the Rochester unemployment rate is higher than the state and all of that stuff. I mean, it's really a sad situation. So we're going to make the greatest trade deals ever made by any country. I'm good at that stuff. That's right. I built a great company, tremendous assets, some of the great assets of the world, Doral, Turnberg, great buildings all over the place. And you know, it's funny, when I put my papers in, everyone said, well, he won't file. You know, nobody knows because I'm private, so nobody knows. So I put the papers in. The press goes there. They were so devastated to see how great. And I'm not bragging about it. I'm just saying that's the kind of thinking the country needs now. They need thinking like thinking. They need smart thinking. Some of the greatest assets in the world, but tremendous cash flow, very, very low debt, and people haven't seen anything like it. And it's, you know, it's phenomenal. And all filed. They all said, well, maybe it'll take a long time to file. I didn't take a long time. I actually filed ahead of schedule. In fact, if I wasn't going to run, I probably would have filed anyway because it's a form of bragging. That's how good the company is. Okay? I think I would have filed anyway. But I made the decision to run. And the reason I did was I had just had it. I watched the Iran deal being made, which now turns out to be a disaster. And I could have said it was a disaster when they started negotiating with infinity years. Did you ever see a deal take so long? Okay. Now, Kerry did not read the art of the deal, by the way. Kerry is an incompetent negotiator. Barack Obama is an incompetent negotiator, except when he negotiates against Republicans. He gets everything he wants. You know, it's interesting. A friend of mine brought up something. They talked about, right, 3-4 years ago, they said, if we could only have the House, we got the House. Then they said, if we could only have the Senate, we got the Senate. And you know what? It's gotten worse. Worse. The omnibus budget is a disaster. It lets people come in from Syria, it funds it. It funds illegal immigration coming across the border. It funds Obamacare, which we're going to repeal. We're getting I said it the other day. First time I said, you know, Obama's a lousy negotiator for us, but he's a great negotiator against the Republicans. It's pretty sad. It's pretty sad. Is it true, though? Is it true? He gets everything he wants. I watched Boehner say, we will not shut down the country. Well, I don't want to shut down the country either. You know, a negotiation for the budget. This is just before he got out. Boehner was there. And he said, we will not shut down the country. Now, he may believe that, and I believe it, and certainly I don't want to do it either. But why do you say that? Why do you talk about it? Now, once he said that, I said, now the Republicans can't make a good deal. Because he gave away all the cards. Once he said that, I don't want to shut down the country. For the press, I'm saying this. Because, you know, they'll say, Trump wants to shut down the country. You know, it was amazing. Sorry, guys, I finished disturbing. So the Times, which is totally dishonest, a total piece of garbage. The Washington Post, these are, how about that stupid Boston Globe? It's worth a dollar. Did you see that story? The whole front page, they made up a story that Trump, they pretended Trump is the president. And they made up the whole front page is a make-believe story, which is really no different from the whole paper for the whole thing. And I think they're having a big backlash on that one. You know, here's a paper that the New York Times spent $1.3 billion to buy. They spent hundreds of millions of dollars on losses and operations. They recomputerized it. They spent a fortune. Let's assume they're in for $1.5 billion. They sold it for $1, and then they do editorials telling me what I should be doing about Japan and about Saudi Arabia and about other countries that we defend, okay? So they wrote a totally dishonest story, totally dishonest, and they basically knew, but they don't put everything in. So we talked about, as an example, Japan or Saudi Arabia or any of them. And I said, no, we have to go to them. They have to pay their fair share. Now, I don't want them to defend themselves, and nobody is stronger and nuclear than I am. It's the biggest single problem that this world has. Not global warming. You know, Obama said the biggest problem we have is global warming. And by the way, it's supposed to be 70 degrees today, and it's freezing. Speaking of global warming, where is we need some global warming? On the whole big section of the United States. It's not just Rochester. The whole big section is like record cold. And I keep hearing about global warming. Now they'll say, he doesn't understand. This is a worldwide problem. Oh, no, I don't understand. Let's do IQ tests. Now, I want to defend Japan and other countries. You know, in South Korea, we have 28,000 soldiers on the line between the maniac and South Korea, North Korea. Right. We have 28,000 young, brilliant, beautiful, wonderful soldiers that are in harm's way. That we love, that parents love, and they're very nervous. And we have this guy over there talking nuclear, talking everything else, and talking about, you know, you ever see his armies, they're very big, and we have our people over there, and we're not properly reimbursed, okay? And Japan is not properly reimbursing. And Saudi Arabia, again, $1 billion a day, what are we doing, folks? They gotta take care, if we weren't in Saudi Arabia, if we weren't protecting them, they wouldn't be there for 1 week, believe me, not 1 week. And yet they make the money with the oil. And by the way, this has nothing to do with Saudi Arabia. I have so many friends from Saudi Arabia, so many friends in Japan, so many friends. I have buildings in South Korea. But you know what? What's fair is fair. I'm more interested in our country. These are people, these are countries that are behemoths, economic Germany. Germany, it's an economic behemoth. By the way, even though she is in the process of destroying Germany with immigration, destroying it. You know that she was person of the year and I would have gotten it if she didn't get it? And now they're saying, I think we made a mistake in picking Turbo, we should have been Trump. I've been on the cover of Time magazine a lot lately. You know what they're doing. The reason I've been on so much is because it's a movement. What we have going is a movement. Now, they're trying to subvert the movement. They can't do it with bodies. They can't do it with people because they don't have near the people that we have. So what they're trying to do is subvert the movement with crooked shenanigans, all right? And we're just not going to let it happen. We're not going to let it happen. We can't let it happen. Because we can bring this country back so fast, so fast. There are so many forces against us. They've been against wage earners for forever, it seems. But 17 years, people have not had an effective wage increase in this area. 17 years, they haven't had. And then you wonder, why are they angry? In fact, a writer came to me and said, Mr. Trump, are you angry? I said, no. I'm not angry. I know what's there. Well, your people are angry. I said, no, they're not angry. They're not angry people. You're not angry people. But you're tired and you're sick of watching the stupidity and the thefts, and you're watching the world take our country away from us, and that's exactly what's happening. So I told you, New York Times, as plainly as you're standing there, and I'm sorry we couldn't get you a chance, there's just too many people. But I told the New York Times, I said, no, no, they have to pay for these services, that something commensurate, even if we lose something, but we can't, we're losing our shirts on every single deal. We lose on trade, we lose on the military. You know, people say we have a military budget, which is true, that's many, many times any budget anywhere in the world. That's true. You know why? Because we're defending everybody else. We're not taking care of ourselves. We don't take care of ourselves. Now remember this. In a deal, and I wrote this in The Art of the Deal, you always have to be prepared to walk. Kerry, there it is right there, one of the great books of all time. The Bible is the best. One of the great books. But I wrote, you always have to be prepared to walk. Now, if Kerry would have gotten up a couple of times from the Iran deal, like, for instance, he should have said, before we start negotiating, we have to have our prisoners back. This is like a place that needs some help, and they closed their plant in Chicago, and they're moving it to Mexico. How stupid are we, folks? How stupid? How stupid are the leaders of this country? We're not going to let them, we're not letting them get away with it anymore. We're not going to let it happen. We're not going to let it happen. So we're going to do things. And I came down the escalator with Melania, and I took a deep breath, and I said, she'll make a great first lady, I will. I took a deep breath, and I said, let's go. And there were cameras downstairs. I say it all the time. I'm telling you, it looked like the Academy Awards. They were, look at all them back there. Look, look what we brought to Rochester today. Look at those people. Look at those cameras.
Oh, if they were only honest, if they'd only really follow the camera. You know what some of them do? They wait till everybody leaves. Now it's empty. And then they'll say, we're here at the arena where Donald Trump, and everybody looks at the this big empty space. They don't show it like this. They are really, really damn dishonest people. But that's okay. You know, after a while, you learn to live with it, okay? To finish up one thing, and then I'm going to tell you where it started and where it's going, and then we're going to have a quick thing, and then I'm going to just tell you one thing, we're going to start winning again. We're going to start winning again. So when I talked about to the New York Times, when I talked about defense or this and that, I talked about they have to pay. And if they don't pay, well, we have to be prepared to walk. So they said, well, would you walk? Well, we may have to be prepared because we cannot continue to go on with this where we're defending Japan. We love Japan. I have many friends in Japan. Love Mexico. Many friends in Mexico. Have thousands of people working from me, Hispanics. And in Nevada, when I had the poll, I won Nevada, the state of Nevada in a landslide. They did a poll of Hispanics. I won the Hispanics by a lot. A lot. Okay? They're great. They're great. But their leaders are too smart for us. Their leaders are too cunning for us. What happens, though, is when I talk about any one of the countries, let's say Japan, I say, no, they have to take care of us. We can't continue to lose the kind of money that we're losing defending all these countries that, by the way, are making a fortune. Look at the cars that come pouring into this country from Los Angeles. You know, the largest ships I've ever seen. They're loaded up with cars from Japan. They come pouring in. And in fact, Obama said the Japanese are very worried about the rhetoric of Trump. They should be worried, honestly. They got to pay. And I'll tell you what, I would bet that I will get along better with Japan. treat, well, treat them very fairly. I want to treat them fairly. I'm going to treat everybody fairly. Look at China. $505 billion yearly trade deficit, and they go and build a massive military complex in the middle of the South China Sea, which they're not allowed to do. And we don't do anything about it. We have so much power over these countries because of the power of trade. And we don't know it. We have leaders that don't realize that we have power. So with Japan, with any of them, but with Japan, I'd say very nicely, listen, we need help. You got to take care. We don't want you to arm. But you know what? You have to be prepared. You have the maniac. Japan is concerned about him. You know, there is a school of thought that Japan would be better off taking care of him and let us sit home and watch it on television for a change. Does that make any sense? I mean, you could make the case. You know, we have now 9 countries that are nuclear, right? 9. So they said, oh, Donald Trump. Now, here's the thing. So I said, no, I'd negotiate with him. I'd be prepared to walk, but I'd negotiate with him, and they have to pay a lot more money. They have to, you know, we got to get our house back in order, right? So I said, I would prepare, and I'd much rather take care of them. They have to pay us, but I'd much rather take care of them. But I would be prepared. The question was, well, would you walk? Yeah, I'd be prepared. So I have these phony stories come out of the Washington Post, which is, by the way, a total rag. What a rag. And the reason it's there is to protect a company, which I'll talk to you about very soon because I'm writing a whole big thing about it. The owner of the Washington Post, do you know what he owns?
What?
Amazon! Do you know how little tax Amazon pays? So he uses the Washington Post to protect Amazon from taxes. Okay? That's all it is, folks. And they go crazy. They write on average like 8 stories a day on me. I have so many stories I can't even read them. I can't even read the good ones when they happen, which is seldom. Which is seldom. And the New York Times, I'm telling you, the Washington Post was purchased by you guys. It was a loser. Losing money, hand over fist. The Washington Post was purchased by the gentleman that runs and has a big stake in Amazon, right? You know his name? Correct, Bezos. You know his name. So, now he uses that as a political weapon because he doesn't want to pay tax at Amazon. That's all it is, folks. It's so simple. It's so simple. And every time they hear me say it, now watch, tomorrow I'll have 15 bad stories in the Washington Post. And all I'm doing is wanting to protect you, folks. I get it. I understand it. I get it. So, don't worry about them. You know what? Their voices aren't strong enough. Just let's... sense to you folks. These are unbelievably dishonest people. I'll give you an example. We had one guy up front, he raised his hand, he said 2 words. We had that person in the back who said a couple of words. Tomorrow the headline will be, major protest at Trump rally. There's no protest. We got 10,000 people. We turned away 5,000 or 6,000, unfortunately. And with all these people, we had 2 people raise their hand. Tomorrow the headline won't even be about defending Japan. It will be about Trump at a protest. Let me tell you, our rallies are the safest rallies of anywhere. And you know what's nice about our rallies? Because a lot of these people are agitators. You look at them, they have professionally done signs. They don't have signs done in their basement. These are professionally done signs. You know what's nice about our rallies? Our people protect themselves. They protect each other. There's something beautiful. That's the way it's called teamwork. That's the way our country is supposed to be. We're supposed to love each other. And we will love each other. We'll love them someday too. But we're supposed to be protective of each other. And there's tremendous love in the rooms when we have these rallies. Tremendous love in the rooms. So on June 16th, come down the escalator, started talking about illegal immigration, and man, did that hit a button. And now, Sheriff Joe from Arizona, we love Sheriff Joe. The Border Patrol, 16,500 Border Patrol people endorsed Donald Trump last week. They did. because I talked really about trade, because we have to make our country rich again. A woman came up to me and said, wonderful woman, incredible woman, 60 years old. I said, how old? She said, 60. I said, you look great. She said, Mr. Trump, don't say we're going to be rich again. I said, I have to say that. Because if we're not rich again, we can't be great again. We have to bring back our money. We have to bring back our jobs. We have to bring back our industry. It's been stripped by these politicians that don't care or are stupid. I said, so we have to make our country wealthy again, and we have to make our country great again. I'm the only one going to save Social Security, folks. Ted Cruz wants to cut it. Everybody wants to cut it. I'm the one person, because I'm going to bring our jobs back, I'm going to bring our wealth back. And believe me, a lot of those jobs are coming back to Rochester. Believe me, there's going to be incentives now. A lot of the jobs. Just remember I said. Remember I said. So, here's the story. So I said on June 16th, I talked about trade, and I talked about the border. The borders and illegal immigration were met with, at first it was quiet, and about a week later, do you remember the delayed reaction? A week later, everyone said, whoa, what did he say? They were all saying, what a good speech that was. A week later, all of a sudden, they just went after me. And I said, wow, now everybody's saying I was right. They're all saying I was right. I also said, we have to be extremely careful with radical Islamic terrorism. And we have to... We cannot stand by and be the stupid people while our country is destroyed. You see what's happening in Germany with the crime. You see what's happening in Sweden with a small little section. You see what's happening in Brussels. Now in Brussels, a number of weeks ago, I said Brussels is a hellhole. Before the accident, before the horrible tragedy. I said, Brussels is a total hellhole. Now, I knew Brussels from many years ago, one of the most beautiful cities in the world. But a couple of months ago, I made the statement, Brussels is a hellhole. The New York Times wrote a story, how dare Donald Trump say that? How dare? Then the blow-up happened. Now they're all saying Trump was right again. It's amazing, right? So, I mean, it's amazing. No, we're right. I'm right. Woo! I wrote in my book. In the year 2000, the American we deserve, I wrote in the book, the year 2000, right? I talked about Osama bin Laden. So one of the television hosts didn't believe it. They brought the book into him. He said, wow, Trump was talking about this 2 years before the World Trade Center came down. I promise you, I would have taken that guy out, and you would have had the World Trade Center. I would have taken him out. I do know, I'm the one that talked about taste the oil, right? I said, don't go into Iraq, it's a mistake, and I said it, don't go into Iraq. I was against going into Iraq. But once we were there, you couldn't get out the way Obama did it. And he gave us an exact date. We are leaving on an exact date. And the enemy sat back and they said, wow. They didn't believe him. They thought it was a camouflage of some type. They didn't believe him. They said, wait a minute, he can't be that stupid. He's giving us a date. He's giving us a date. He adhered to the date. Now, I said, don't go into Iraq, but you can't get out without leaving some people behind. Not that it's worth it, because it's such a, you know, you talk about hellhole. There's another hellhole. Now, Iraq is being taken over 100% by Iran. They've been wanting to do that for decades and decades and decades, right? But they're taking over Iran. Iran is taking over Iraq. The second largest oil reserves and great stuff in the world, and they're taking it over. We made it possible by decimating Iraq and their army and their military. We made it possible. So Iran's wanted it for years. So not only did Iran go and make one of the great deals ever with us, but then they made a much better deal because we decimated Iraq and Iran is now taking it over, okay? And let me tell you, they're taking over Yemen. When you look at the border between Yemen and Saudi Arabia, they don't want Yemen, they want Saudi Arabia. And never was Saudi Arabia in the trouble they're in now. And they don't want Saudi Arabia, they want the oil. Okay? And what I'm saying, folks, is they gotta pay. They gotta pay. They gotta take care of us. Why are we the dummies all the time? They gotta take care of us. So when this started, I was talking trade, very strong. I was talking trade and I was talking borders. By the time it finished, we had a thing called Paris. And speaking of Paris, if some of those people in that room had guns, and the same thing with California, some of those people in those rooms in Paris or in that room in California where these two radicalized people that worked with them, who were given baby showers for their child, If some of those people on the other side had guns, wouldn't have been the same story, folks. It happens, 130, toughest gun laws in the world, 130 people killed. Boom, 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 boom. If some of these people were there and they had guns strapped to their waist or strapped to their ankle, it would have been a whole different story. That wouldn't have even happened because they just debated that those people had guns, let's leave them alone. So folks, we're going to start winning again. Okay? We're going to start winning again. So important. This is a movement. They want to stop the movement, but I don't think they're going to be able to. This is a movement. This is millions of people. No matter where you go, I go to Dallas, we have 21,000 people. I go to Mobile, Alabama, we have 35,000 people. Like, no matter where we go, we have the biggest crowds by far. Nobody comes close. The biggest problem we have is we can't get them into these massive hangars. We can never get enough people in. But we have a movement going. It's an incredible movement. It's actually not a movement of hate. It's a movement of love. Remember that. It is. It's a movement of love. It's a movement of people that want to see our country be smart and strong and great again. It's a movement of people that want to be taken care of and they want to take care of. They're going to take care of. It's a movement of people, really, that want to start winning again. Because we don't win. We never win anymore. We don't win on trade. We don't win on the military. We don't win on education. By the way, we're ending Common Core education. So it's so important. We got to keep it going. Everyone says, oh, you have these great poll numbers. We need a great show of strength in New York State. It's so important. A great show of strength. You got to go, not this Tuesday, but the next Tuesday. You got to go out and you got to vote en masse. You got to bring your friends. You got to tell them about it. You're going to say this was one of the great days of your lives. You're going to say when you cast that vote in 9 days on Tuesday, you're going to say it was the greatest single vote you've ever cast. And here's what's going to happen. We're going to start winning again, folks. We're going to win with our military. We're going to knock the hell out of ISIS. We're going to win at the border, we're going to build a wall, and people are going to respect us, we're going to have our country back. We're going to win with education, we're going to end Common Core, and we are going to bring it low, and we are going to keep them educated. We're going to repeal and replace Obama. We're going to protect our Second Amendment. And we're going to bring jobs back into this country like you've never, ever, ever seen before. We're going to have a great economy again. We're going to have a great, great country again. And you're going to be so proud of your president, but I don't care about that. You're going to be so proud of this country. The American dream, and I've been saying it, the American dream is dead. But I'm going to make it big.